Hi, I am Kakra Baiden, and I want to tell you why I wrote this song. I woke up around 3 a.m. and I fell into a trance. My eyes were drawn to my window, and I saw a huge angel suspended in the air. He took out a trumpet.
Welcome to today's service, and here is the Catch the Anointing Center news. You can now join in our services on TV on the following days and times. On Sundays on ATV from 11:15 to 12:15 p.m. The New Believer School comes up every Sunday right after the second and third service near the Info and Event Station. This is all believers who want to be established in the Word of God and be properly integrated into the church. Online meetings are also available. Join in and lay a solid foundation for your Christian life. It's Prophetic Family Service with Bishop Kakra Baiden live at the Catch the Anointing Center headquarters off the Mungwatema Beach Road this and every Wednesday from 4 a.m. to 7 a.m. Come with your family and friends and start your day with a powerful and prophetic blessing. You don't want to miss this. Bond of Marriage. Raphael Smith and Linda Bokete getting married on Saturday, 19th November, 2022. The venue is the Catch the Anointing Center headquarters, Matthew Chapel, and the time is 1 p.m. Courage Kwashi Jr. and Stacy Furiwa-Ohene are getting married on Saturday, 26th November, 2022. The venue is the Catch the Anointing Center.
Gospel of the Kingdom, if the Gospel of the Kingdom was resurrection and he was still alive.
Dates: Saturday, November 19th, 6 a.m. Sunday, November 20th, 6 a.m., 8 a.m., and 11 a.m., and an afternoon session at 3 p.m. The theme is transformation. Don't miss out.
All announcements should get to the info or event station by Tuesday evening or send our email to lsimorningstar@yahoo.com. Thanks for watching and enjoy the rest of the service.
Amen. Amen.
Our hearts to be thankful.
help your children. And don't let us fall by the side of the road. Amen.
Hallelujah. Why don't we begin by praying? Let's pray and let's ask for the visitation of the Holy Spirit. Wherever you are, just lift your voice and let's pray for a visitation of the Spirit. Oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the ways Thy hands have made,
I see the stars,
I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder.
Let's sing.
Then sings my soul. going to pray for our country. We're going to pray that God will bless our country. See us through economic crisis. See us through whatever problem that has come. So lift up your voice and pray for your country. Father, heaven, I want to thank you so much for today. We pray that you speak to us. Have mercy on me. Give me the tongue of the learned, that I may know how to speak a word in season to him that is weary. Holy Spirit, this is your meeting. I pray for the spirit of revelation. Let us see, let us hear, let us understand what the Spirit is saying. I pray, give me the soul of a weaned child. Use me for your glory. Let the wind of the Spirit begin to blow. Speak to everyone here in Jesus' mighty name. Everyone say amen. You may be seated this morning. Tell your neighbor you're welcome to church. My life belongs to God. Everything that I am, Jesus, only you deserve the praise. The devil has no power over me. I am the child of God, Jesus, only you deserve the praise.
The one who helps,
the one who helps, who owns my life, the one who loves me, Jesus, know the strength of all my life, the one who helps, who owns my life, the one who loves me, Jesus, you're the strength of my life belongs to God. Everything that I have, Jesus, only you deserve the praise. The devil has no power on me. I am the daughter of God, Jesus, only you.
The one
who helps, who owns my life, the one who owns me, Jesus, you're the strength of all my life. The one who helps, who owns my life, the one who owns me, Jesus, you're the strength of all.
Hallelujah. I think I've been sharing on how a Christian should respond to economic crisis. How a Christian should respond to economic crisis. As Christians, the Bible tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 4, that the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. In other words, they are not natural. There is a natural response to things, and there is a spiritual response to things. Many natural responses are understandable, but they are not spiritual. For example, one day I was walking on the road and I met a stranger. That day, I don't know why the stranger did that, but on that particular day, I was fasting and praying for 3 days. And when I passed by this man, he gave me a hefty slap for no reason. On the road, in town, my natural response was to return the slap. This was years ago. As soon as I raised my hand, I heard the voice of the Holy Spirit. And he said to me, Jesus said, when somebody slaps you on the right, turn the left, let him give another one. That scripture just flashed. Then immediately, I just restrained myself. And I just continued walking. If it had been natural, if I'd returned the slap, it's a natural response. And when I explain it to you, you will understand it. So there are many things that people will understand. That's natural, but it is not spiritual. But the response that came from the Holy Spirit that I should just move along or forget about this guy and just keep on going, it was a spiritual response from God's word. So sometimes if you're not careful, you can confuse a natural response with a spiritual response. Why? Because everybody understands you. But that is not the response that God requires from us. So our weapons are not natural. Primarily, we look at God's word as revealed by the word of God or the Holy Spirit to respond to anything at all. In 2 Peter 1, verse 19, the Bible says, we have also a more sure word. The word sure means reliable word. Of prophecy. When he says of prophecy, he's talking about the Old Testament books. Mind you, at this time, the New Testament had not been written. The New Testament was written or was compiled 200 years after the death of Jesus. That's when it was compiled. And the reason why it was compiled is that people were writing many fake books. Even the Apocrypha is one of them. So they decided to just put the authentic book written by witnesses of Jesus who heard God's voice together to form the Bible. So since we have this sure word, reliable word, whereunto you do well that you take heed. To take heed means pay attention. In a time of economic crisis, you can pay attention to the news. You can pay attention to forex movements. You can pay attention only to cryptocurrencies. You can pay attention to your salary. You can pay attention to rumors. But the Bible says, when it is dark, it says it is time to pay attention to God's word. A mortal word of prophecy. Whereunto you do well that you take it as unto a light that shines in a dark place. So anytime you are in a dark place, be it you've lost somebody, be it you've lost some money, be it times are hard, be it somebody is dead, there's always a light for you in God's word to guide you in that dark place. But most of the time, when we are in that dark place, we don't look for light. We look at something else. So the tendency to look at something else is very strong. That says, take heed. Until the day dawn and the day star arise in your hearts. The day star is one of the titles of Jesus. And I think the day star arise in your hearts, it means that you have a conviction of the Holy Spirit in your heart. That's what it means. But the day star was a star. And the star, that star, is, I think it's Venus. It's so bright sometimes in the morning that you would think that the sun has arisen. But the sun has not arisen. It is just a star. And then when you see it, you think it's morning, but it's not morning. But literally, the sun itself will arise. So that's what it means, literally. But I think that it means that you will receive a conviction in our hearts. And after that conviction, then it will be made clear that either Jesus has come or whatever has to happen will happen. Anyway, that's by the way. So it says that until the day star, like this conviction, That's what I think it means. Arises in your heart. So, in these times, I told you the Holy Spirit woke me up in the morning and said, I have prophecy. So I've been prophesying for the last 2 weeks. Every time I say a prophecy from the Lord. The book of Isaiah is a prophecy. Long book of 66 chapters. It's a whole prophecy. So a prophecy can be very long. So Adam say it's a prophecy. So I'm speaking as a prophet. So the Holy Ghost said to me, this is what I want you to tell my people. I said, what is it? He said, tell them they shouldn't behave like unbelievers. They said, how should they behave? He said, in a time of economic crisis, that is when I bless my people. May you be blessed in Jesus' name. Yesterday, somebody said a nice testimony with me. He said, he went to sleep. And in sleep, I came to his room and told him, the doors have arrived. Tell someone, the doors have arrived. He said he woke up from sleep. And when he woke up, he received a phone call. A contract he had been expecting for about 3 years, 3 years ago. The guys come for the money. The dollars have arrived. This is going to be the best time of your life. Can I hear your amen? So the Holy Ghost said, anytime there's economic crisis in the Bible, I've used that opportunity to bless my people. So instead of being afraid, instead of being confused, let's look for divine guidance so that God can bless us. In Luke 21:25, Jesus said, there shall be signs in the sun and the moon and in the stars and upon the earth, distresses of nations with perplexity. The word distress means pain. So Jesus said, nations will undergo pain, not a nation, nations. And now in the world, nations are undergoing economic pain. Food prices rising, bread is getting lighter, cake is having more wrappers than the cake itself. Everything is getting slim apart from you. Everything is losing weight apart from you yourself. That's the wrong area to lose weight. Anyway, so, and he says with perplexity. The word perplexity means confusion. But you don't need to be confused. In verse 28, Jesus said, when these signs begin to come to pass, look up for what? Divine guidance. So you and I don't have to panic. We just have to look up for divine guidance. So I gave you three examples. In the time of Jeremiah, when the king of Babylon came and destroyed the whole of Jerusalem, and Jeremiah was in prison, people were selling their lands because the land had become valueless. Because they were going to, all Israel was going to be taken captive to Babylon. God told Jeremiah, Jeremiah 32 verse 7, it says, Hanamil, the son of Shalom, thy uncle's son shall come unto you saying, buy my field that is in Anatoth. He said, your cousin will come. Times are bad. So he wants to dispose his land. God told him, this is the time to buy. To unbelievers, it was the worst time. But to Jeremiah, it was the best time. Jeremiah bought the land. He bought Kakra. In verse 15, he said, and I weighed him 17 shekels of silver. Then God told him, verse 15, he said, houses, fields, and vineyards shall be possessed again in this land. So God told him the value will rise again. So when people were selling, Jeremiah was buying. Divine guidance. Same thing to happen to Isaac. In the midst of the famine, Genesis 6 verse 12 says, Isaac sold in that land. Same thing happened to Joseph. In the midst of 7 years of famine, Genesis 41, 29, it says, there come 7 years of famine. That was when Joseph was planting for food and jobs. That's when he was doing that thing. He was rather investing and expanding farms for Pharaoh. That was when Pharaoh blessed Joseph and Egypt more than any other thing in the time of that famine. If God is subject to economic conditions of the world, then he is not God. My grace is sufficient for you. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9. My strength is made perfect in weakness. Therefore will I rather glory in my infirmities or my weaknesses, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Paul said, when we are weak, that's when God's strength is at its peak. Therefore, he said, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities. He says, when there is even shortage, Paul said, that's when I'm happy. In persecutions, in distresses, for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, watch out, then I'm strong. Samson in the Bible was a very slim person. He wasn't a muscular person, very slim. If you see him, he looks like an ordinary person until the Spirit of God comes upon him. But the interesting thing is that anytime there was a problem, that's when the Spirit of God would come upon him. Samson went down to Philistines, and the Philistines came upon him, and the Spirit of the Lord came upon him. Samson went down, and a lion roared against him, and the Spirit of the Lord came upon him. At this time, that is when the Spirit of the Lord is resting upon you, because it's a time of weakness. It's a time of weakness. So I said, what should we do? Number one, I spoke about revelation. There's a revelation and guidance. May God guide you. All these people, God guided them. God spoke to them about what they should do as individuals. Very few people have prayed and asked the Lord. As people are changing money into dollars and panicking and crying about inflation, I am sure very few Christians have asked the Lord, what am I supposed to be doing? People have consulted everybody apart from God himself. But all these three people, there was one thing that was unique about them. They consulted God himself. And God himself told them what they should do. Because every person's situation is different. So the advice that is good for me may not be good for you. The wisdom of the tortoise is different from the wisdom of the rabbit, because they are different animals. The tortoise cannot run. So in his wisdom, it has made a hard shell. It is into hide. It just hides under the shell. And even lions don't eat them. The rabbit has no shell. So in his wisdom, it runs for safety. So it can run very fast. But both of them can survive. Assume the rabbit wants to be like the tortoise. He said, when the lion is coming, see the tortoise standing there. So he wants to stand there and face him. No chance. It's dead. That's why each one of us needs specific instructions for the Holy Ghost. And let me tell you one easy way that the Holy Ghost speaks to you. He puts an idea in your mind. Thoughts. Matthew 10:20. When they deliver you up, Jesus said, take no thought what you shall see. He started talking about thoughts. He said, the Holy Ghost shall give you in that same hour or instant what you shall see. In other words, he will plant a thought into your mind. That's one way that God speaks to us. When you sin, or you are doing something wrong, that's a thought that comes into your mind that what you are doing is wrong. Who do you think is talking to you? It's the Holy Spirit. So you can say, oh, prophet, you've seen an angel. Okay, forget about angels. We are talking about thoughts now. We are talking about thoughts now. God plants thoughts into people's minds. But you see, you must be able to discern. Because there are thoughts that are demonic. So you must be able to discern. That's why you need to be spiritual, so that you can tell the difference. When you're unspiritual, you cannot tell the difference. Even a godly thought, you think is your mind. But when you are spiritual, you can discern between the two. 1 Corinthians 2:14 says, the natural man receiveth not. The problem is not that God is not speaking. He is speaking, but he cannot receive. Because he's too carnal. So don't be a carnal Christian. So that when God speaks, even in your thoughts, you cannot tell. Amen. Number two, I spoke about understanding. When the famine came in Joseph's time, Pharaoh asked Joseph, what are we going to do to survive this economic crisis? In Genesis 41 verse 33, Joseph said to Pharaoh, therefore let Pharaoh look out for a man discreet and wise, and let him set him over the land, the whole land of Egypt. Joseph told Pharaoh, in a time of economic crisis, two qualities we need is, number one, he said, we need to be discreet. And number two, we need to be wise. That word discreet is the word understanding. That same word is translated understanding. Literally means understanding. And that is what God gave Solomon, and became the richest man in the world. Same word. But in that particular instance, the word that is used, English word that is used, is understanding. It can be found in 1 Kings 9, where Solomon said to God, give therefore thy servant an understanding heart. It's the same word. That's what Solomon had. Then 13, God told him, I've given you that which you have not asked, but riches and honor. So God told Solomon that understanding, it brings riches and honor. There is something that Steve Jobs understood about phones and made the iPhone, that made him a billionaire, that you and I don't understand. Maybe you know how to mend chaliwate, but understanding how to mend chaliwate cannot bring much. He understood something. So, I said one thing that we must pray for, understanding. I said, we do a story. Yes, I was working in Europe. I lack understanding. I was looking for a job as a laborer with black shoes on a construction site. And I didn't know, nobody employed me. I thought it was witches. I prayed, still I was unemployed. Then one morning I was sitting down, I asked the Holy Spirit, why don't I have a job? He said, it's because of stupidity. So he said, look at your shoes. And I looked at my shoe. I was wearing black shoes. Then he told me, there is no laborer who wears black church shoes. Such people, they are found in banks. So I went and bought builder's boots and made them dirty so that I look experienced. The following day, I was hired immediately because God made me understand why I didn't have the money. Until you understand something, you cannot solve it. If you don't understand how a car runs, you can't repair it. If you don't understand how a TV works, you can't fix it. That understanding what is causing a problem, you cannot solve it. So whatever economic crisis we find ourselves in our businesses, in our personal lives, in the world, may we understand what is going on so that we can have solutions towards it. Number three, he said wisdom. That's all the wisdom. Pharaoh said, Joseph said to Pharaoh, a man of wisdom. This was a problem. Genesis 41 verse 29. There come 7 years of great plenty throughout all the land of Egypt, and there shall arise after them 7 years of famine. In other words, an economic downturn. The next thing that was required, Joseph said, is wisdom. You know, in Proverbs 15 verse 2, the Bible gives one of the definitions of wisdom. It says, the tongue of the wise uses knowledge. All right. There are three interrelated words which can sometimes overlap, but they're so different. Wisdom, understanding, and knowledge. It's like the rainbow. You see that the colors match, but they're also distinct. Here the Bible says, wisdom is the ability to use knowledge practically. You can have knowledge, but you may not be able to use it. You can have a master's in finance and not be able to buy a car. You have the knowledge, but you can't use it. One day I visited somebody who had a doctorate in animal farming. Doctorate. And the person told me that he had some cows. So I asked the person, so where are these cows and who's looking after these cows? And the person said, I have employed a Fulani boy to look after cows. And I said, I thought you are the one who has the doctorate in animal farming. So I am expecting you to use the knowledge that you have to look after your own cows. But now an illiterate Fulani boy is the one who is raising the cows based on his experience, not knowledge. Then I said, look, I think you should raise these cows scientifically based on how you were trained. So you can have knowledge, but you will not be able to apply it. And that's the problem of Africa. So many graduates, so many technical people, our problem is a lack of application. How are we going to apply it so that there will be tangible results? That's the problem. You know, there's one thing about wisdom. I think that one feature of wisdom is that wisdom is practical. Practical. And when you lack wisdom, you're not a practical person. Largely, wisdom is practical. In Proverbs chapter 28, verse 19, the Bible says, he that tilleth his land shall have plenty of bread. But he that followeth the vain shall have poverty enough. Here the Bible is describing two people, maybe they are even friends. One has land and he uses what he has. Practically, he uses the land. Another has land, but he imagines things that don't exist. So he has a hoe, he has a cutlass, but he won't farm it. Because he's imagined that somebody should give him a combine harvester as a gift from Ukraine, because he has heard that there is a war there. So that's what he's planning. So in his plans, there are many things that lie outside his control. A lot of things that have to come together to make plan work is based on assumptions, people's benevolence, and things you cannot control. That is planning with things that don't exist. Money that does not exist. Opportunities that don't exist. That's vague. And you'll be surprised, there are a lot of people who plan like that. In their plan, there are seven things. Out of the seven, two depends on them. Five, they don't know how it will come, but they say one day it will work. It's not practical at all. You know, I've been watching the Chinese people are building those that overhead. And I've seen that all the things they are using are found here. Even in building the overhead, they didn't use the big steel sections, the big steel I sections. No, they're using iron rods. That's the normal ones we used to be, the bigger ones. That's what they are using. And they are using formwork. And they are using metal scaffolding. And they are casting bit by bit, and they are going. I have not seen any sophisticated machine in the place, but they are building it. Why did we not build it ourselves? Because in our minds, we are playing with other people. We are playing with World Bank. We are playing with this. We are playing with that. We are playing with it. We have not planned with what we have here. We are planned with things that don't exist. That's why. In economic crisis, if you plan with imaginations, things that don't exist, you become very poor. One day, there was a brother in our church. He had first degree. He didn't have a job. So he came to see me, counseling. He said, I don't have a job. So I said, so what exactly do you have? He said, when my mother died, he left me with a job and a diffuser. An empty freezer. So that's all I have. So I said to him, so what is the shop? He told me the shop is empty. Because he does not have capital to fill the shop. Then I said, no, at least there is something you can do. So he asked me, what can I do? Then I said, the deep freezer. Go and buy water, stock it, and start selling water from the deep freezer. Then he said, oh, but I have a first degree. I said, doesn't matter. Because this is what will work. Your first degree is not working. This is the thing that will work. So let's plan with what we have. The freezer and the pure water. So this guy started selling the water from the freezer, the pure water from the freezer. And as he was selling, he started making money. So then he bought his own small machine. He started making the water himself. Then he started making a lot of money. Then he expanded it and expanded it. Then he opened a shop that was now selling building materials like cement and all from that same business. Then he opened yet another one. Till one day he invited me to his building site. Look, he was building two houses at the same time. One on the left, one on the right. Workers. Pack, 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 pack. The guy had prospered. Why? Because he decided to be a practical person. Look at you, say, my neighbor, don't plan what you don't have. Always plan what you have. Till your own land, and it will work. Amen. It may not be big at the beginning, but it will grow. It will grow. Then we had another guy in our church. He was unemployed. And I asked, why are you not unemployed? He said, I've registered a company. Then I said, okay, so what's going to be next? He said, I'm going to employ 20 people. They'll be working for me, then the money will be coming. So I said, so what business is this and where are the 20 people? He said, oh, I'm praying and I'm just there. I know one day it will be well. Then I told him, make sure you don't go mad. I suspected that it would be borderline madness because this type of thinking. Said this may be borderline madness. So I told him, I said, listen, what you are saying, make sure you don't go mad. As it was a prophecy. Dude, after some years, he went mad. Yes. Because mad people, they plan with things they can't see. They see people who are not there. They hear voices that are not there. They see buildings that don't exist. So sometimes when people are old, it's very small. So it's borderline madness. That's what it is. Wisdom. So Joseph said, listen, let's just plant corn. It's as simple as that. Let's do the job. Let's plant the corn. We have corn. We have land. Let's do it. But the difference is that when you know God, God blesses you. An unbeliever can do the same thing, but it will fail. You do the same thing, and it will work. Because there's an anointing on your hands. That's the difference. That's the difference. Number four is faith. Tell somebody faith. Faith. In all the three examples that I gave earlier on, Isaac, Jeremiah, Joseph, one thing that they all had was faith in God's word. What I'm saying that I said, the Lord gave me a prophecy. If you don't have faith in God's word, you won't believe it and you won't do anything. In 2 Kings 6:24, the Bible says, it came to pass after this, that the king of Syria gathered all his host and went up and besieged Samaria. And behold, they besieged or surrounded it, until an ass's head was stolen for 40 pieces of silver, and the fourth part of a cup of dove dung for 5 pieces of silver. A cup was a dry measure, like a lunka. And dove dung is it was some kind of seed that they call dove dung. Prices went high, even an ass's head. The price has gone high, very high. And once again, that principle holds true. In a time of economic difficulty, that's when God blesses his people. So there was great economic distress. Even women were eating their children as kebab and steak because there was no food. Then Elisha said, 2 Kings 7:1, hear ye the word of the Lord. Thus saith the Lord, tomorrow about this time shall a measure of fine flour be sold for a shekel, and 2 measures of barley for a shekel. The gates of Samaria. You see, what they needed, the first principle I gave you, revelation or divine guidance. So what Elisha said is not different from what I am telling you today, that in the time of crisis, that's when God blesses his people. Otherwise, there is no God. So what I'm saying, I said, God told me. It has happened before. It's not new. You don't even need a visitation. It's written in the scriptures. Verse 2. Then a Lord on whose hand the king leaned answered man of God and said, if the Lord will make windows in heaven, said my esteem be. Then the finance minister said, hey, according to well-bound projections, according to inflation rates, according to what is going on in the world, he says it's possible. Then the prophet said, behold, thou shalt see it with your eyes, but you shall not eat thereof. What I am saying, only people of faith will eat of it. Only people of faith. When the prophet rose up and gave the divine direction, the finance minister, a man on whose hand the king, it means that he was somebody that the king depended on. And I think he was a finance minister. He said, if the Lord will make windows in heaven, my destiny be. But the prophet said, thus saith the Lord. Faith is key. Faith in God. You know, in a time when naturally things are bad, faith is key. Why? I'll give you some reasons why it's key. Look at someone like Abraham. He was 100 years old and his wife was 90. When God said, you have a child, it's impossible. In Romans chapter 4 verse 17, the Bible says, as it was written, it is quoted in Genesis chapter 12. Written where? Genesis chapter 12. I have made thee a father of many nations, before whom he believed, even God, who quickens the dead and calleth things that be not as though they were. God promised a man 100 years old, a woman 90, give them a word. I said, listen, you're not going to give birth to a child. He said, you're going to create a nation. Verse 18 says, being not weak in faith, he considered not his own body now dead, when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's soul. He staggered not at the promise of God to unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God, that which he had promised, he was able also to do. You see, for you to have faith in God, Abraham had faith in God. Why? He believed two things about God. Number one, if you read verse 17, it says, God quickens the dead. In other words, God can raise the dead. The most impossible situation that human beings cannot solve is raising the dead. Amongst humanity, raising the dead is the most difficult thing. We can make planes, we can make cars, we can make whatever, we can make computers, we can do make technological things, but to raise the dead, impossible. So he said, if you can believe that God can raise the dead, which is like the highest of the most wildest problem you can ever have, if you can believe that, then it means that God can do all things. He raises the dead. That's why in the time of this crisis, you must believe that, look, if God can raise the dead, then if your business is dying, he can raise it. If finances are dying, he can raise it. May God resurrect everybody's finances. Amen. I said, may God resurrect your finances. Amen. Then the second thing about God, he says, he called the things that be not as though they were. In other words, things that don't exist, God confesses that they shall exist. If you want to move in faith, you should have these two qualities. You must believe that God can do everything. And you must believe that even things that don't exist, or you don't see it in your family, you don't see it around you, still, it can be done. He called the things that be not as though they were. He confesses things that don't exist. Before you buy a car, you must talk about it. Before you become anointed, you must talk about it. Before you marry, you must talk about it. Before you have money, you must talk about it. Why? Because you are calling the things that be not as though they were. Yesterday, I told my wife, I said, I think I'm about to make $1 million. Why am I saying that? I am calling the things that be not as though they were. That's how God works. I told my wife, in these hard times, I think I'm going to make $1 million. Have I seen anything? No, I haven't seen anything. But I am operating at the level of God's faith. And I'm waiting. When I see some movement, then I'll say something. You are behaving like somebody who was born in Kakra. Behave like somebody who was born in heaven. Born in heaven, born of God. Faith. And when you have faith, you know what happens? It gives you strength. The Bible says he was strong in faith. Faith supplies energy. It makes you strong. It doesn't make you give up. It gives you courage. It gives you energy. It gives you power. It stirs you up. Faith. Look at you and say, my neighbor, don't look at your pocket. Don't look at your circumstances. Don't look at your unemployment. Look at God. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Believe God. Paul said, I believe God that it shall be even as it was told me. So it's not based on what I see around me. He said, it is based on what I have been told in the scriptures. Number five, innovation. Tell somebody innovation. What is innovation? Innovation is the introduction of, number one, new ideas, and number two, new methods. The introduction of, number one, new ideas, and number two, new methods. There's something about life. In life, you always have to be evolving. In other words, you have to be changing. The reason is that the context or the circumstances in which you find yourself is always changing. So you cannot remain the same. Those who insist on remaining the same, they become history. History is a record of past events. They join the record of past events, not current events. The world is always changing. Even your age is changing. Your age doesn't stay the same. What you did when you were 17 years old, you cannot do it now. When I was 17 years old, we wake up 1 a.m. and eat a big pot of rice in the middle of the night and go to sleep. In the morning, we eat breakfast. After we eat lunch, and then we eat again. And even after that, we are still growing slim. We don't grow fat. 17 years old. When you are 40, you can't live like that. You gotta change. If you don't change, you will die early. You've got to change. So even when it comes to even normal eating, if you don't change, something will go wrong. Personally, I don't average, I don't eat in the night. It's rare for me to eat in the night. Once in a while, I eat in the night, but it's not my habit at all. At all, it's not my habit. If I eat it, then it's once in a while. But my normal habit is I don't eat in the night. But I used to eat in the night all the time, but now I've changed. But my age cannot support such a lifestyle. If I do it, I'll be inviting diseases into my body. So even if I want, I have to restrain myself that I don't develop this normal habit. No, you can't support it. In a time of famine, whatever things that you were doing in good times, you cannot behave the same way in a time of famine, because the whole context and circumstance has changed. Everything has changed. It's not the same scenario anymore. Prices are not the same anymore. Things are not the same anymore. So what you used to do, if you persist in doing it, it won't work. Why? Because we are in a different season altogether. You cannot wear summer clothes when it is winter. It's not possible. The season has changed. It's, oh, you know, the summer, this is what we used to wear. But well, now it is winter. Better find some heavy, heavy clothes and wear. Otherwise, you freeze to death. We should never say, change your clothes. So some of us refuse to change our clothes. You know, there was something about Joseph. Let's talk about innovation. I said, no, it means the introduction of new ideas. When Israel moved to Egypt for the first time under Joseph, Pharaoh asked Joseph, what will your people do? Then Joseph told Pharaoh, we are herdsmen. We keep cattle. That's what we do. That's our business. So Pharaoh gave them a place called Goshen, because the Egyptians were not in cattle and all those things. So he said, okay, go and stay in Goshen and do your cattle. When the farming came, the cattle were not available. Was not available. So somebody who has not been trained as a herdsman, now he said to Pharaoh, now I'll be a farmer. I'm going to plant corn. Well, that's not what they do. They don't plant corn. They look after sheep. They were shepherds. But you see, in a time of famine, you need to innovate. You can't remain the same, because the situation is totally different. You know, yesterday I was having a conversation with them. 2 days ago, some guy in his church, he tells me they have been selling bread and the bread prices have gone up, and we were talking and all those things, and he was telling me that if they raise the prices, he doesn't know if people will buy. Then I asked him a question. I said, do you have data on the people who buy the bread? Then he said, oh yeah, I think we have some data. Then I said, have you bothered to find out by using the data, the people who buy the bread, how many of them will be okay if you raise the price, and how many of them will not be okay? Then he said, oh, I've not found out. We are just selling the bread. Then I said, when prices are raised and you have data, you can determine who can afford a raised price and maintain the quality and sell at a higher price. And for those who want a lower quality with a lower price, you also tell them that you are reduce your sugar and your thing. You're going to become like a rock, but that's what you want. It's as simple as that. So I said to him, so really, the problem is not the price. The problem is managing your customers and the data and knowing their I know before. Because they've never seen 7 years of famine before. How do you store corn for 7 years? New methods. Same corn, but right now must have new methods. Joseph came out with storage ideas and technology. How they can store corn for 7 years that weevils will not eat the corn. Amazing. Because that happened before in their lives. So even to think about the storage, you have to bring new methods of storage. But you see, sometimes when you read the story like that, you tend to emphasize on the spiritual and forget all the practical things that took place, plus the spiritual, that made the impossible possible. But you must put all together before you will see the hand of God. And overemphasis on the spiritual alone, it leads to poverty. Every miracle is a combination of the natural and the supernatural. When Peter got a bumper cart, Jesus blessed him and he got a bumper cart. It was not just a prayer. Number one, he had the skill of a fisherman. He had been trained as a fisherman, so it involved training. He owned a boat. It involved capital. He had partners. It involved forming a company. He was a hard worker because all night he had been trying, and when it didn't work, he went back into the sea to try again. He worked very hard. So if you look at all the elements, a skill plus capital plus other people plus hard work plus prayer, that produced the thing. But you don't have a skill, you don't have the boat, you don't have anything. You are only wanting prayer, and you say it will work. Nothing will work. You need all things coming together for the thing to work. That's the problem of Africa, where people have overemphasized prayer, that other things that come together to let the thing work, they have been left behind. It accounts for the poverty. Is prayer plus benefits. Do you think that was just a revelation? Nah. Because a man was into silos. He has never seen a silo before. He has never stone core before in his life. But it calls for what? Innovation. So whatever we are doing, my brothers and sisters, maybe the old ways aren't working. But the new ways will work. It calls for innovation. New ideas, new methods. I pray that God will give us revelation. Recently, I found a job for somebody in America. Friend of mine, talking to me, told me I don't have a job. I said, really? Then I said, I'll find a job for you. My friend asked me where. I said, I'll find a job in America. So I called another friend of mine who is in America. And I told him, have you considered having a personal assistant who is in Ghana? And my friend is in America. He said, will it work? I said, it will work. Then I said, he's a businessman. So I said, talking from a business angle. I told him, you lower your cost. This is how much you pay my friend. It will far cheaper. If you get someone from America, this is how much the person will charge. And I said, all your online work, all your this, all your that, you want to fly, you want to buy grocery, this personal assistant will do the grocery, ship to your house, do this, do that. I never done that before. He was saying, he said, he told me, I'll try your friend. To hide my friend. All the work my friend does is online. And my friend has been working for this businessman ever since. Because to him, it's very cheap. So every time I see my friend and the dollar is going up, I say, hey, life is good for you. Put your hands together for Jesus. I say, life is good for you. Innovation. But you can be working and say, I don't know. You say, there's no job. Listen. The introduction of new ideas. Mayala kashata kabuka barianda bushala barianda barianda. I want to end with a suggestion. For teachers, if you are a teacher in this house, if I were a teacher, do you know what I would do? I will learn what a primary school is learning in America, a high school is learning in America, if it's physics, whatever, I will learn whatever course that they are learning, and I'll teach them from there, from here, by Zoom, and charge them in dollars at a lower price. That's what I would do. I'll study it. So I'll have two jobs. I'm a math teacher in Chicago. And now I'm a teacher at Transformer. Innovation. The introduction of new ideas. Our people's children. I'll study the subject and I will teach. Do you know how much it takes to hire someone to teach your child? Very expensive. But the good thing is that here we can lower the price. Fantastic. So don't sit down and blame the witches in your family. Blame a lack of what? Innovation. The man introduced modern farming techniques. Silos. Plantations of corn. Well, he himself has never planted corn before. May the Lord help us. Why don't you stand to your feet and begin to pray for yourself? Pray for yourself. Pray for yourself. Pray for yourself. Be a teacher in Chicago, teaching somebody to show them maths. What an awesome girl. Marianda Bashala Kabarianda Bushada Bukabarianda Buyanda Buriana Alianda Bashala Bazanda Bukabariala Bariala Bariala. I will never be more loved than I am right now. Wasn't holding you up, so there's nothing I can do to let you down. It doesn't take a trophy to make you proud. I'll never be more loved than I am right now. Going through a storm.
Going through a storm, but I won't go down. I hear your voice carried in the rhythm of the wind to call me down. So I won't drown. You never be closer than you are right now.
Somebody say Jireh.
You are Jireh. You are enough.
Jireh will provide for you more than enough.
Jireh, you are enough.
What's more than sufficient?
I will be content. You are child, you are enough.
Forever,
forever enough.
Always enough,
more than enough.
I'm telling you, God is more than enough. Child,
forever enough.
You provide
always enough.
All cash
more
money.
Enough.
I don't want to forget.
I don't want to forget how I feel right now on the mountaintop. I can see so clear what it's all about. Say
you are going to even trust at the home, because he's your Jireh.
I will be content in every circumstance. You are Jireh. You are enough.
If he dresses the lilies, Lord, he will look up at you.
If he dresses the lilies with beauty and splendor, how much more will he clothe you? How much more will he clothe you? If he watches over every sorrow, how much more does he love you? How much more does he love you? If he dresses the
for innovation. New ideas, new methods. Ideas move things. When our ideas are finished, everything stops. Ideas, they are the engine, the fuel of movement. Let's pray that God will grant us ideas, new methods, new ways of doing things, a new way of thinking, ideas, new things. When your ideas get finished, your movement stops. Because your ideas are finished. A lack of ideas, it impedes progress. Ideas are the fuel for movement. When our ideas are finished, then we are sad. May God breathe fresh ideas. Fresh idea in our system. Pray for yourself. This is a very important problem. Most of the time the question is, what am I supposed to be doing? What can I do? His ideas. Father, we thank you for today. Lift up your two hands and let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name, I pray for the breath of fresh ideas, innovation. Whenever we find ourselves standing in front of a wall, it means ideas are finished. We pray for new ideas, new methods. Let the Holy Spirit bring things to mind. Let the Holy Spirit bring things we have never thought of before. Walls that stand in front of us give us ideas that make us go over the walls, go around the walls, break through the walls. Let the breath of God breathe upon your people, watching, listening, present. The breath of fresh ideas. God says, I'll pour out of my spirit upon the flesh. Your sons and daughters, they shall see visions. Let your spirit pour out. Let there be new visions, new sights, new ideas, new methods. Pour out your spirit. Let everyone here be touched. Let everyone watching be touched. Let there be a change. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for hearing our prayer. Amen. Put your hands together and be seated. Take out a good offering this morning. Make sure that your offering is good. Jehovah Jireh means the Lord your provider. Jehovah Jireh, it means the Lord your provider. And the song says, He dresses even the least. He will provide for us. He's more than enough. A friend of mine called me from America. He said to me, are you worried about the price increases in Ghana? I said, I'm not very worried. He said, why? I said, since I was born, prices have been increasing. We are still here. I said, since I was born, prices have always been increasing. But God has always proved himself to be true. Lift up your offering list for a breath of new ideas from the Holy Spirit. Father, as we give to you this morning, I pray for new ideas. Innovation. Let it be our portion. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. I will never be more loved than I am right now. Wasn't holding you up, so there's nothing I can do to let you. Doesn't take control of me to make you proud. I'll never be more loved than I am right. Going through a storm, but I won't go down. Hear your voice carried in the rhythm of the wind to call me. You will cross the ocean. So I won't drown. You've never been closer than you are right now. You are Jireh. You are enough. Jireh. You are enough. I'll be content. Shall drive 1,000 and 2 shall drive 10,000. The reason why 2 do it will drive 10,000. But when you are 2, it's you and God. So the whole thing changes. May the Lord help you. Uzziah became great because the Lord helped him. May the Lord help you. Father, I pray for supernatural help and godly help for your children. In Jesus' name, amen. This week, coming week, is our convention with Apostle Dan Carson. No place to put your hands together for Jesus. We don't want to waste too much time in traffic, so that we're going to have a Saturday early morning, 6 o'clock. So that we close early and wherever you want to go, whatever you want to do, you can do it. So we're going to start Saturday. No traffic, nothing. 6 a.m. in the morning. Please wake up early and be here. We could have done it in the evening, but it wastes too much time. The driving, the traffic, the going back, the tiredness. Sunday too, we have to come to church. So Saturday morning. Just take it as a time of retreat. Early in the morning, the Bible says, they came to him, that is Jesus, in the temple. Jesus used to like to preach early in the morning in the temple. He'll be sitting there. So it's going to be an awesome time. The man's coming all the way from America. And every man of God comes with a unique anointing. So you don't want to miss this anointing. That man is coming because of somebody. You know that? Every man of God who comes because of somebody. Tell your neighbor, it might be you. It's going to be an awesome time, Saturday morning, 6. By 9, we've closed. You want to eat, watch it, whatever you want to, you can go and do it. Your whole day is free. It's ahead of you. If I say 2 p.m. or 3 p.m., it will go on and you can't do anything. Your whole day is spoilt. So please wake up very early. I know you don't wake up early most of the time, but this today, wake up very early, 6 o'clock sharp. Pray a bit, and then the man will come minister. It's a good time to pray. Maybe 6 to 7, we should pray. Hot prayer, 1 hour. Who would like to pray 1 hour? Hot prayer. Yes, 6 to 7. Let's pray. Then, Sunday, he'll be here again. He'll be preaching in this service on Sunday, 1st, 2nd, 3rd service. I think that's about it. Sorry, and Sunday evening, yeah, 3 p.m., right? Sunday evening, 3 p.m., we'll continue. It's going to be an awesome time. We've chosen Sunday because also Sunday in the evening, we don't expect much traffic. So it will help. If you're going to celebrate your birthday in the coming week, please stand up and let's pray. Where are you? Coming week, you're going to celebrate your birthday. Please stand up and let's pray. Please come. Come and let's pray. Let me have some envelopes for birthday people. Next Sunday, make sure you give the Lord an offering for your birthday. Happy birthday, happy birthday, happy birthday to you. Don't go, I'm coming to pray. Happy birthday to you. On your birthday, thank the Lord. Next Sunday, come and thank the Lord. Anything that He lays on your heart, at least you are right. Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday to you.
Let's pray. May the Lord make you the head and not the tail. The Lord make you the head and not the tail. May you be above and not be beneath. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Happy birthday and God bless you. Shall we stand to our feet as we close today? Before we close, maybe today is the very first time you are worshiping with us, or you don't Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, and you would like to dedicate yourself to serving the Lord. When you know God, you know it in your heart. I don't have to tell you. It's like falling in love. I don't have to tell you you're in love. You yourself, you will know. When you know God, you will know. Yeah, today Pastor Ansby's mom is here. The family, where are they? Clap for them, please come. Good reminder. Pastor Ansby's mom is 80 years old today. 80 years. Today, I want the family to come with her. Let's pray. So they are supporting her on her 80th birthday. Lord, to be 80 and be able to even move. God bless you. So bless you. Mama, happy birthday. Eighty-five years old. Yes, that was his auntie. To live for 85 years is not easy. Even to buy bread and cocoa every morning for 85 years, it's not easy. Try it. Shall we pray? Father, in Jesus' name, I want to thank you so much for our mother. We commit it into your hands. We thank you for the age of 80 and your blessing. We pray for mercy. We pray for grace. We pray for health. We pray for guidance. We pray for revelation. We pray for goodness. We pray for peace. We pray for love. We pray that she draws closer to you. We pray concerning her walk with you. Oh Lord, lead her yourself. Lead her. Your word says you hear a voice say, this is the way, walk in it. We pray that you bless her children and all that are related and connected to her. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. If you turn around and we take a photo. Where is the photographer? We take a photo. God bless you, Mama. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, happy birthday, happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, happy birthday, happy birthday to you. May you all come and celebrate your 85th birthday in church. May you celebrate your 80th birthday in church also. If this is the very first time you're worshiping with us, or you want to give your life to Jesus, please come to me. First time visitor, you want to give your life to Jesus, please walk to me. Through that we are in the last days. Right, visitor, you want your life to Jesus, please come. Clap for them once again. The only way to heaven.
Holy Spirit is true, then your life's here on earth is good.
Welcome.
If I were you, I'll take my chance while I've been made.
Welcome, my brother.
If I were you, I'd take my chance while I have my.
Lift your two hands, let's pray. Father, I pray for your children. Pray this prayer for me. Say, Lord Jesus.
Lord Jesus.
Today I repent of my sins.
Forgive me.
Come and live in my heart. Be the Lord and Master of my life. Thank you, Jesus, for coming into my heart. I am the Kashiro Kobujuna, my Shara Kalaurio Nevasan. Layanda Buyu Kavarianda Bushara Kobuzada Buzianas. Romia Lakianda Bushara Parianas. Roma Shira Kalakurianda Bushurkanda Shira Kalabuzianas. Roma Kalab Shokobuzanda Shikala Kalakura Kalabuzunis. Ayanda Bushurkanda. After you take them, look at neighbor, see my neighbor, I'll see you Wednesday. In the morning for the midweek service, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, love of God, communion, fellowship, contribution, and participation of the Holy Ghost with you now and forevermore. Amen. God bless you.